What's up, guys? Welcome to not Let's Learn, but instead just a looping tutorial, I suppose we might call it. This is a new thing I'm trying, and I'm not sure if it's going to be interesting to anybody at all. But basically, what I want to do is take some songs that I like to perform live and kind of demonstrate how I like to build layers of loops to kind of fill the sound out a little bit more. I have a few bags of tricks that I use to try and make me sound like a lot of people, including my loop pedal, my vocal harmony pedal, which I'm not sure if this will work. But I don't know if you can hear my voice harmonized right now or not. If not, just believe me that I pressed a button that should make me sound like two people. And I also have a kick drum that I usually keep under my left heel and a tambourine under my right heel. But without further ado, I want to talk about loops that I use for Castle on a Hill by Ed Sheeran. So, I got my headphones on so I can hear what the loop pedal is doing, and also it's feeding to my recording software. So, what we're going for in the end is going to sound like this. Right? Because that progression is used in the verses and the chorus. So, the individual sections of that, I can trigger them independently with this pedal, so it's kind of luxurious. I'm using a Boss RC50 for anybody that cares, but the three parts I have sound like this. Right, so that's just running high notes. And then I have my percussion. And I have the roots. Right, so if I were to bring in the percussion like that, so when I'm doing this live, it kind of depends on the room a little bit what order I do this. Usually, I like to have the beat first, and I use that as a reference for everything else I record into the pedal. But in actual fact, say it's like a busy bar or something and people aren't paying that close attention, I can get away with that. But if I'm playing a room where people are actually like watching and want a show, I can't just be there like, right? Because people are gonna be like, this is not that good. And there are ways around that, right? Like if you just look really excited about your mutes, like all good. But for the sake of argument, let's say you can't get away with doing that first. So it's a little bit easier to seem excited about like chords you're strumming. So from the top, here's kind of how this process goes. It'd be. So that sounds pretty good, and that's accurate. Those notes are accurate to what the real recording is. I like to fill it out a little bit by putting some high notes over it up there. So it'll be. And that sounds pretty good to me. Next, I'll throw in my percussion. That's really the extent of what's going on, at least in the chorus. I'm sorry, in the in the chorus and the verse. In the pre-chorus, there's some stuff on the toms. It's not super easy to replicate that, but something that I like to do to kind of help build it later on is I'll put in the hi-hat just by. Right, you can do whatever rhythm you want. It might even be better a lot of the time just to keep it straight and clean. So like, and again, for the sake of argument, I'll do that now. Sometimes I'll do two layers of this to kind of. So like, there's one layer, and I'll let you hear the difference with two, just if you're curious. Kind of like that sound better. And you know, that's why I'm strumming. It isn't just the same volume every time. I'm trying to do like bah, 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 bah. It kind of gives the loop more of a feeling of motion. emotion. Now, the reason that I let the loop go so long, right? So if I stop everything, the reason I don't just do, you know, like two bars, just and, right? That in itself would loop, but if, and it would sound okay. But if I want to put any moving part under that, like, that by itself isn't going to be long enough for me to do the whole bass line. So it'll just be like, you know what I mean? So that would obviously not be very good. Now, the way that this actually plays out, I put that bass line on a separate track. So I've got track three here. And the reason why is because the pre-chorus follows a different progression. So it's... I never know the words to anything, but found my heart and broke it there, made friends and lost them through the years, right? That kind of thing. So if I were to have that like verse bass line looping all the time, that would just sound like garbage because the chords would be wrong. So I like to put that in and then drop that out at that section. So if I have all the things going, and let's say I do loop that bass line there. There we go. So I might let that run. I did that loop kind of badly, but I might let that run for the verse, and then when I get to the pre-chorus, I'll stop that track. And I can't wait to go home, I'm on my way. Right, so... you end up doing some fancy footwork. I know not everybody has a loop pedal where you can do separate tracks, and that's okay. What I would suggest then is pretty much every loop pedal I've ever seen has an undo function. So I would put all that stuff except for the bass line on the one track and do the bass line last, because what you can do then is record your bass line in and you know, let it run. And then when you get to the section of the song that... that does have that line drop out and change the chord progression, just undo it, right? So all the other stuff will keep going. And then when you need that line back in, just redo it. Typically, that's just hold the undo button again and it comes back. So yeah, that's how I like to do my loops on this song. Once again, I know that this is kind of a new concept, at least for the videos I do. I do an awful lot of this stuff kind of in my own shows and stuff, so I have no idea if this is interesting or useful to anybody. So seriously, please let me know. Even if you hated it, just let me know. And, you know, I won't be upset. I'll just know not to do these videos anymore. And, that'll be all. So thanks for watching, and I'll see you later.